If you've ever been scuba diving or snorkeling, you likely came across turd-like sausages on the ocean floor, sea cucumbers. Despite their name and their motionless lifestyle, they are animals. And although they look like weird sea versions of slugs, worms or millipedes, they are actually closer related to us humans. Their closest relatives, however, are starfish, sea urchins and sand dollars, with which they form the echinoderms. Despite sea cucumbers looking intrinsically harmless, they are actually quite the opposite if you aren't careful. In this video, we will discuss why that is, as well as everything else that makes these little turds interesting. Enjoy! A defining trait of echinoderms is their radial symmetry, consisting of usually five mostly identical body parts. You can find this symmetry in sea cucumbers too, but it's far less obvious than in sand dollars or starfish, for instance. If you were to stand a sea cucumber upright on its mouth or its anus, you can, however, still see the symmetry in the five body segments that connect these two points, at least in some species. So in comparison to starfish and sea urchins, sea cucumbers essentially lay on their sides. Because of this, they have also evolved a weak bilateral symmetry, as their individual segments have developed differently. Three of them form the trivium, the foot so to speak, while the other two form the bivium, the dorsal face. Each of the segments has a row of tube feet, similar to those you can find on the underside of starfish, that allow the animal to crawl along. On the dorsal face, these tube feet are often underdeveloped or lacking altogether. Other species have repurposed them as a form of protection or as sensory organs. The ring of feeding tentacles around their mouth are similarly modified and enlarged tube feet. These can be retracted into the body by a set of retractor muscles when they feel threatened. Additionally, five lengthwise running bands of muscles allow the sea cucumber to expand and contract its body. Sea cucumbers don't have a brain. Instead, they have a simple system of nerve strings that extend from the nerve ring near the mouth, the central hub of the sea cucumber's anatomy, and run longitudinally along the walls. With this rudimentary nervous system, they are able to detect touch and chemical stimuli, and coordinate all their bodily functions, including their movement. Responsible for locomotion in sea cucumbers, like in all echinoderms, is the water vascular system, a system unique in the animal kingdom that works almost entirely hydraulically, so through water pressure. In starfish, part of the system is a sieve-like orifice on the upper face of the animal, through which they can take in seawater. In sea cucumbers, however, this sieve is regressed, making their water vascular system a closed circuit. Other than that, they work almost entirely the same. From the central ring canal, five rows of canals branch out to each row of tube feet. Each of these canals is connected to hundreds of ampullae, little sac-like structures that expand when water from the radial canal is pumped into them. Each ampulla is linked to a single tube foot. Through contraction of the sac, the sea cucumber forces water into the tube foot, causing it to extend and push against the ground. Minute muscles control the direction in which it points. Similarly, a relaxation of the sac makes the foot retract again. Through hundreds of these little feet, individually but coordinately controlled, sea cucumbers are able to crawl along in any direction, but only very slowly. Similarly spectacular is their respiratory system, because sea cucumbers essentially breathe through their butts. Their main respiratory organs are two trees of hollow, highly branched tubes, called water lungs. These trees are attached to the cloaca of all things. By closing the anal sphincter muscle, they can force water into the system, allowing them to breathe. Even more absurd is that some animals, after analyzing their options, decided that this is the best place to live, inside the cloaca of sea cucumbers. A variety of fish, most commonly pearlfish, as well as a few species of scale worms, and also some crabs, use the anal cavity of certain sea cucumbers for protection from predators. These are so-called commensalistic symbiotic relationships, so relationships that, as opposed to parasitism or mutualism, benefit one side and don't negatively impact the other. Still, some species of sea cucumbers have developed anal teeth, presumably to keep the unwanted house guests out. Sea cucumbers can be found in every ocean around the world, in shallow waters as well as the deep sea, down to depth of up to 10 kilometers. On the deep sea floor, they make up the majority of animal biomass, up to 95% in some places. Here, giant herds of sea cucumbers, consisting of millions of animals, wander across the ocean floor in search of food. In addition to their numbers, they are also surprisingly diverse. Over 1700 species are known today. The biggest of them can reach a length of up to 3 meters. The smallest measure only a few millimeters. Typically, however, they are between 10 to 30 centimeters long. Sea cucumbers feed on detritus and debris, algae and plankton. Essentially everything that ends up in their mouths and is usable gets processed. They typically use one of two strategies to acquire their food. Some species are filter feeders. These usually have developed large feathery tentacles that they flay on the water column to catch free-floating plankton. But most of them are sediment feeders that use their tentacles more like shovels to fill up on mud and sand from the ocean floor. These materials then make their way through the intestines, while the organic matter in it is digested. During this process, the organic particles are broken down into far tinier pieces, which are then excreted together with the undigestible sand and will become fodder for even smaller life forms. So similarly to earthworms in terrestrial ecosystems, sea cucumbers, by filtering sediments and recycling nutrients back into the food web, play a major role in the biological processing of the seabed. A single specimen can digest more than 45 kilos of sediment a year. Legend has it that every grain of sand in the ocean has, at some point or another, been excreted by a sea cucumber. Even their reproduction seems perfectly fitting for their crude lifestyle. Instead of going through the trouble of dating, they simply release both eggs and sperm into the surrounding water, hoping that they meet. To maximize fertilization success, this usually happens simultaneously in an area. Sea cucumbers are also notable because they possess diverse regeneration abilities. Some species have the ability to recover from a loss of 50% or more of their body, which they sometimes use deliberately to reproduce asexually. Basically, the sea cucumber splits itself in half and each half regrows into a full sea cucumber. Other echinoderms, such as starfish, have similarly the ability to regrow lost body parts. Some can regrow limbs, and a few can even regrow a completely new body from a single arm, or even an arm fragment just 1 centimeter long. As cool as this is, it doesn't change the fact that on the face of it, sea cucumbers are quite benign animals, and seemingly easy prey for predators. However, the majority of them have, despite their apparent helplessness, developed effective defensive mechanisms. Many of them use the most obvious method of protection for such an animal. Toxin. Most species carry a toxin called holothurine in their organs. Some can even release it through the skin when they feel threatened. This toxin is so effective in killing small animals, particularly fish, that it was in the past even used by fishermen from the Indo-Pacific to hunt fish. Most sea cucumbers have, in addition to that, the absurd ability to expel their inner organs from their butts, sometimes from their mouths, and discharge them into the surrounding water. This is called evisceration and is meant to distract or scare predators away. As brutal as this seems, this behavior doesn't kill the sea cucumber. As mentioned earlier, they have incredible self-healing capabilities, which allow them to simply regenerate the organs in the following weeks. A few species have even developed a special organ for that purpose, so-called cuvarian tubules. These are long white tubes that are attached to one or both respiratory trees. If the sea cucumber is attacked by a predator, it will expel these sticky, stringy, sometimes toxic threads out of its anus. The resulting net of strings can entangle, immobilize, and even kill potential predators, and gives the sea cucumber the opportunity to crawl away. This is yet another way these sedentary animals can defend themselves. As a result of these multifaceted defense mechanisms, sea cucumbers are typically avoided by generalist predators. A few highly specialized ones, however, do prey on them. Among them, two species of sea snails, the giant tun and the partridge tun. These basketball-sized snails are immune to the sea cucumber's toxin. They have, however, their own very potent poison that they use to paralyze the sea cucumber. After all, when you're a snail, a sea cucumber running away from you is a real concern. Paralyzed and with their toxins not affecting the snail, the sea cucumber then has to experience being swallowed whole and alive, which concludes the most boring hunt in the animal kingdom. For humans, touching sea cucumbers is, aside from allergic reactions to their toxin, generally not life-threatening. The contact with their toxic breaths, outer skin or ejected innards can, however, cause sometimes painful skin irritations, maybe similar to jellyfish stings. If the toxins come into contact with your eyes, they can even cause blindness when left untreated. So, as long as you don't know what you're doing and what kind of sea cucumber you have in front of you, you're probably best advised to leave them be. Needlessly stressing wild animals by touching and picking them up is a douchey thing to do anyway. Just watch them from afar. That being said, not every sea cucumber species is poisonous. The ones that aren't, and even a few that are often considered a delicacy in many places, particularly in Asia, in countries such as China and Japan. In Japan, the history of sea cucumber fishery dates back over 1,000 years, to the 8th century. Here, sea cucumbers are traditionally served in a form of soup. But this too isn't always safe. It can happen that species get confused and meals aren't prepared correctly. When that happens and you accidentally eat a poisonous sea cucumber, the effects of their toxin are a lot worse. It can cause severe abdominal pains and vomiting, numbness and breathing difficulties. A few people have even died after eating poisonous sea cucumber. But given how many tons of sea cucumber are eaten every year, these cases are extremely rare. Because of an ever-increasing demand over the past few decades, particularly in China, substantial numbers of sea cucumbers are now bred and cultured artificially in seawater ponds and sea ranches. Depending on the region, it takes between 2 to 6 years for an individual to grow into marketable size. The Japanese sea cucumber is the most important and valuable commercial sea cucumber species, and China is by far its biggest producer. In 2017, their total production amounted to 200,000 tons. This makes sea cucumber farming a multi-billion dollar industry for the country. But not every sea cucumber was content with their life as vacuum cleaners of the ocean. Some of them have developed bodily features that allowed them to lift themselves up from the ocean floor and take to the skies. 26 of these swimming sea cucumbers are currently known, but it is suspected that there are more of them. Most of these inhabit the deep sea and are incredibly rare, which is why it's understandably difficult for scientists to shed a light on this remarkable and elusive subset of sea cucumbers. The most famous of them is probably the fittingly dubbed headless chicken monster. These equally beautiful and bizarre-looking sea cucumbers have repurposed some of their tube feet and developed them into three webbed veil-like sails. Like their ground-bound relatives, these sea cucumbers are sediment feeders. In between meals, however, they spend most of their time swimming, using their sails to sometimes rise as much as 1 kilometer above the ocean floor. This allows them to avoid ground-living predators and to find better feeding grounds. Pelagothuria natatrix, another species of swimming sea cucumber, takes this way of life to the extreme. They have left their ground-living lifestyle behind completely. Unlike the previous example, they spend their entire life off the seafloor, using their feeding tentacles on top of their almost circular umbrella to catch plankton and algae. They are the only known sea cucumber, even the only known echinoderm, that truly conquered the open ocean. All this makes sea cucumbers truly amazing little animals, that even after more than 350 million years on this planet, are still going strong and as successful as ever. Yeah.